From Crema Media in Johannesburg, this is the Real Economy Report. Our top stories this week. Electronics manufacturer Sony is preparing to launch its 3D television into private homes. While Europe flounders, Africa booms. And Southern Africa establishes a regional energy efficiency center. Three-dimensional technology has been around for some time, but technological advancements have made it possible for consumers to enjoy in-depth viewing in the privacy of their own homes. Marianne O'Donnell finds out more about this.
Consumer electronics manufacturer Sony is preparing to launch its 3D televisions into the homes of its customers for interactive and engaging viewing. What was once the domain of the filmmaker and only seen in cinemas now includes home entertainment in all forms. Sony South Africa brand manager Andrew Fraser explains.
For the home television systems that we'll be using, we use what's known as high frame rate technology, and we actually produce multiple frames, one frame for the left eye, one frame for the right eye, in succession with glasses that alternatively block them out. So we call them an active shutter solution. The big thing about 3D technology is it adds a new dimension to what you're watching, literally another dimension. So instead of seeing things in a flat surface, they appear to have depth. You see it, your brain is fooled into thinking that the images actually have depth. It's a very engaging experience, and that's really going to roll out into, we're seeing it in the cinemas already, we're now seeing it at the World Cup with 25 of the matches being filmed in 3D, and gradually it's now going to be filtering into people's homes. Sony's about to launch 3D LCD TVs into the home. We have 3D Blu-ray players already in the markets. PlayStation 3 is already a 3D compliant gaming system. And it's going to roll out. We've just released a firmware update for one of our still cameras, which allows for 3D panoramic shots that you can take with a still camera. So what's happening is that what was really the domain of the filmmakers is now becoming kind of personal contents as well. So you can have stuff in your home. For home entertainment, I think we've had solutions in the past using what they call anaglyph systems, which is kind of your red and blue colored glasses. They never really worked that well, and to a large extent the content wasn't very engaging. But so the concepts are not really new, it's really just about the technologies that now we have high frame rate LCD TVs so that we can do the sequential frame system.
The African Development Bank recently released its African Economic Outlook 2010 report. Keith Campbell has the story.
Africa's economy has the wind in its sails. African Development Bank Chief Economist and Vice President, Professor Mthuli Nyube, gives us his forecast for the continent's growth until the end of 2012.
A growth of 5% in average GDP growth. That's 5% average GDP growth is what we're expecting Africa to grow, at least between now and 2012. The African growth will still be quite robust compared to other regions around the world. It will be slightly ahead of other regions, certainly ahead of Europe, ahead of the US, still behind the big giants such as China, India, and so forth. But it's at least it just falls at the number two position behind those large giants.
There are several reasons why Africa's economy is doing so well, Professor Mube.
First of all, is good economic management has been beneficial to Africa, macroeconomic management. These skills on economic management were honed in during the long years of economic reform programs, which started in the early 80s and ran all the way. Now we have situations where African countries themselves, African governments, are designing their own economic reform programs, which are market-friendly, and there's a lot of skill in the quality of macroeconomic management, skilled people in government. I think that in that macroeconomic management has resulted in a strong current account positions and also in prudent spending in the public sector. In fact, prior to the crisis, you had a few countries, many countries with surpluses, and also in both in the current account and capital account. But also the resilience factors also come from diversification, that some countries have been successful in diversifying their economies.
Southern Africa can look forward to the establishment of a regional energy efficiency center. A memorandum of understanding has been signed and Crema Media was there.
The Central Energy Fund, AMSA, as well as the CSIR, signed a memorandum of understanding which sets the basis and the foundation for the establishment of an African Regional Energy Efficiency Center to do research and development in terms of energy efficient building materials, as well as extending, of course, to other areas where one can look at saving energy in terms of appliances and so on and so forth. But over and above the research, it's about creating a center which can do the accreditation, the testing of materials and technologies that we bring into South Africa to support our energy efficiency objectives.
With the demand for energy efficient products to alleviate our problem, we're finding a lot of inferior products entering the country. This particular center ultimately will be able to do a check, not a standards check like the Bureau of Standards, but a check in terms of the efficiencies, that the efficiencies are actually there that the manufacturers are claiming.
We'll start our negotiations now with other partners and alliances like the Department of Energy of the United States. That will all go through Dr. Dlamini and Barry Bredenkamp from CEF. And we are just, industry is just in the background putting the whole deal together, and we have set aside for ourselves about 2 to 3 years to have the project completed. It will include a laboratory which is state of the art as far as thermal testing and optical testing is concerned for the building envelope materials and heat transfer. It will include a training center.
So there is a huge need to develop human resources that can support the establishment of energy efficient industries in this country. The work starts today.
And now for a sneak preview of this week's Engineering News magazine. In our cover story, we report on the excitement over a pilot project being rolled out in the coastal town of Claremont in the Western Cape, where greener, low-income subsidized homes are being constructed. South Africa shows a strong first-half vehicle sales rebound. And read about the new techniques and tools needed to make the European A380 Super Jumbo's wings. And in Mining Weekly this week, the Australian mining sector sees a revival in investment after newly appointed Prime Minister Julia Gillard scrapped the disastrous super profits tax. We report that gold miner Simmers has ditched its onerous rights offer and has opted instead for a more favourable funding alternative. And South Africa's state-owned Industrial Development Corporation has asked government to step in to protect the DRC mine that was expropriated from copper miner First Quantum last year. That's Creamer Media's Real Economy Report. Join us again next week for more news and insight into South Africa's real economy.